We come now to the point in the service where we pray, and I wanted to just give you a few updates to your prayer list. First of all, we wanted to extend Christian sympathy to the family of Eileen Olson, who passed away Friday evening, and they will be contacting me this afternoon and finding out when the memorial service, but they're trying to get that worked out for early afternoon on Saturday because all the family are out of state, so please keep them in your prayers. We want to lift up Christy Thornton, who is Perk and Betty's daughter-in-law, married to Ed, as she has surgery tomorrow. And we also want to let you know that Gloria Dalderman and also Wanda Burnett are in rehab now following their surgeries. So keep these and all those who are on our prayer request every single day in your thoughts and prayers. So let us go to God in prayer. Lord, we praise you and thank you this morning for allowing us to be here and for your call upon our lives to be the church. And during these moments, as we celebrate with our worship to you, may you be honored and glorified through everything that we do, not only today, but in the days ahead. We want to lift to you, God, those that are hurting, particularly those who are struggling in their health or those who have lost loved ones. I pray that you bring them peace and comfort as only you can do. We pray for those who are burdened with the cares of this life, and pray that you'd surround them with your presence and let them know, God, that you're not only a God who is with them, but you are a God who loves them more than they could ever imagine. We pray, God, for those who are on the front lines of the pandemic, and we pray that you would continue to set the wheels in motion, that we can get this behind us and that we can move to the new normal, and that you would please come and intervene in our world where we have people who are angry and those who are difficult to deal with because they are stressed out over what's been transpiring the past year. Help us as the community of faith to set the example of what it means to be a faithful disciple of yours. And if there is an opportunity for us to diffuse anger and hostility in the world, help us to be the ones to step forward and to relieve the suffering of the present age. I pray for those who are first responders and all the police officers and all those who work in fire and emergency personnel. Pray that you keep them safe as they serve their communities. And we just pray, God, that you would help us to appreciate those who provide services for us every single day. And God, we pray this morning that your Holy Spirit will be poured out upon us as we are your people gathered for worship in person and online. We pray all these prayers in the name of Jesus, who taught his disciples to pray, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil, for thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen.
Hey boys and girls, Mr. Doug here with today's object lesson for you. And we're going to talk about Ascension Sunday. Yes, that's what we're going to talk about. That's what we're celebrating today. Now, wait a minute. Hey, I'm filming. Are you ready? Okay. Today we're going to talk about Ascension Sunday. And what? You want to know what's Ascension Sunday? Well, okay. No, that's not what that means. Ascension Sunday is when we talk about when Jesus was here on earth after the crucifixion. And he was alive with the disciples and they got to see him and talk with him and everything else. And this was the day that he went back to heaven. And so they saw him rise up in a cloud and go into heaven. Yeah. But it's also a really good lesson for us boys and girls. It is. See, the apostles, they were there with Jesus. And they were kind of, you know, at first they didn't know what to do. They were scared. And then he showed up and they was like, wow, this is great. You know, he did. He rose from the dead and they believed him. And they were all fired up. And then they left. And they're all looking up in the sky. And they heard this voice. And this voice said, the same Jesus you see leaving on a cloud will return. Yeah. And you know what happened next? They did stuff. That's right. The funny thing is in this story is that we know that Jesus goes to heaven and we're told that he will return again. Now the disciples were standing there and they were waiting. They were waiting. You know, they were watching him in the sky. They go, well, let's just wait. Let's just wait till Jesus comes back. We'll just stand here and we'll wait. But that's not what they did. No, they became doers. Yeah, they started doing stuff. That's right. So they started doing so. You know what the first thing they did? They filled Judas's spot. They did. They found a new disciple. And they went out into the world telling about Jesus and all the good news. In a lot of ways, as Christians, we fall into the two categories. Are we waiters? Do we wait around wondering, whatever's going to happen will happen. This is going to happen. Or are we doers? And that's what we should be. We're called on to do the great ministry. And we're supposed to go out and tell people the good news. Because why? Because the same Christ who has left will return someday. And so we're supposed to be doers. Now, what does that mean by being a doer, Sally? That's right. It means doing stuff. There's tons of stuff to do. Now, I know that things are starting to get back to normal. We're fixing to crank up Vacation Bible School. Yeah, you're excited about that? We have tons of places for people to volunteer for teaching, working in the nursery, all of these things. When we're out in the world, we have a chance to spread the word of Christ to everyone we meet and everyone we see. Don't be a waiter. Don't stand around looking, waiting for things. Be a doer. Get out there. Do things. Because he will come back one day. And when he does, we want to make sure that we've done all our part. Ain't that right, Sally? And so, I'm with us today. I always want you to think to what you can be doing. Don't wait around. Don't wait for someone. Oh, someone will ask me. Someone will do this. No. Be a doer. Seek out. Do more. As always, glad to see you here. We're praying for you, and we love you. We'll see you next Sunday. Bye.
I don't know about you, but I was overwhelmed with gladness to see the children back in worship this morning, and so wanted to thank them and also Kimberly and Dana for their leadership with the children. And I wanted also express my appreciation to Trish Glenn for playing today, and to Jerry for preaching. I was supposed to be at a district weekend, but it got canceled, and so I'd already scheduled Jerry to preach, so I was looking forward to that anyway. And so Jerry, thank you for being here. We now come to the time in the service where we focus upon what we feel God is calling us to give and be involved in the church. And for those of you online, there will be opportunities for you to give alternately. And for those of us who are here live in worship, is a time to be reminded that as you leave, you can drop your offering in the baskets that are on the outside walls of the sanctuary. And so let us bow together this morning as we pray. Lord, we know that you are a giving God, and that every good and perfect gift comes from you. And Lord, it is our desire this morning and every morning to be disciples who reflect your nature. And I pray that you would come into each and every one of our hearts and help us to be giving persons, in order that your kingdom will come here on the earth as it is in heaven. Help us during the coming days to be extravagant in our generosity toward you, toward your church, and toward one another. And we pray this in the name of Christ. Amen. Thank you.
My mama used to think when I started out on the Hickory Creek circuit that she had dreams of me being a big preacher, but I don't think this is what she meant. But if I can find my belt under my stomach, I'll put this thing back on. If it jumps off, I'll just grab it and put it somewhere. Well, I won't say nothing else. I want to thank Stephen for asking me to preach today. Stephen used to come to my office when it was in the administration building at Martin College. He looked different then than he does now. And I couldn't remember why he came to see me. And he remembers me calling him when he was coming here and saying, you know, I remember you coming by the office to talk to me a lot, but I don't remember why you came to talk to me. And then he said, you were my first district superintendent. And I thought, Lord, how could I forget that? But I think you were out on a little church named Bethel, outside Pulaski. And so our friendship goes back a long way. Stephen is a sincere, humble, and committed Christian man. And any church that has that kind of person as a pastor is blessed to have that quality of being. Now, I'm going to do things a little different. Not much, or I'll get confused. But I'm going to ask you to remain seated for the reading of the scripture, and then I'll have you stand for saying what we believe in response to the scripture. Reading from the book of Acts, the words of Luke, who also wrote the Gospel of Luke, who refers to the beginning of that gospel that he has made a real serious study of what he has heard about Jesus' ministry and teachings, and was putting it in some kind of orderly fashion so that someone named Theophilus would be blessed by what he wrote. That's how he started the Gospel of Luke. This is how he begins the book of Acts. In my former book, Theophilus, I wrote about all that Jesus began to do and teach until the day he was taken up to heaven. After giving instructions through the Holy Spirit to the apostles he had chosen, after his suffering, he showed himself to these men and gave many convincing proofs that he was alive. He appeared to them over a period of 40 days and spoke about the kingdom of God. On one occasion, while he was eating with them, he gave them this command: do not leave Jerusalem, but wait for the gift my Father promised, which you have heard me speak about. For John baptized with water, but in a few days you will be baptized with the Holy Spirit. So when they met together, they asked him, Lord, Are you at this time going to restore the kingdom to Israel? He said to them, it's not for you to know the times or dates the Father has set by his own authority. But you will receive power when the Holy Spirit comes on you, and you will be my witnesses in Jerusalem and in Judea and Samaria and to the ends of the earth. After he said this, he was taken up before their very eyes, and a cloud hid him from their sight. They were looking intently up into the sky as he was going, when suddenly two men dressed in white stood beside them. Men of Galilee, they said, why do you stand here looking into the sky? This same Jesus who has been taken from you into heaven will come back in the same way that you have seen him go into heaven. This is the word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God. Let us stand together and say what we believe. I believe in God the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and buried. The third day he rose from the dead, he ascended into heaven, and sitteth at the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From thence he shall come to judge the quick and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and a life everlasting. Amen. You may be seated. He ascended into heaven. He ascended into heaven and sitteth at the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From thence he shall come to judge the quick and the dead. When I was a child, I thought maybe if I'm quick enough, he won't be able to judge me. Well, that's not what it means. It means the living and the dead. Well, this is Ascension Sunday. Doesn't get much play in the church, like Easter or Pentecost or Christmas or even the temptations, a season of Lent. Ascension just sort of is there. We just sort of skip over it. I think to our detriment, we do that. It's such a significant event. Maybe not altogether wanted or desired, but it occurred. Ascension Day was Thursday this past week, which is 10 days from the day that we celebrate, 40 days from the day that we celebrate Easter, and then what happens in 50 days? Pentecost. He just left. He went away. Left them standing there looking at an empty sky, wondering what was going on. Before the sky became empty, he was hidden in a cloud that represents the glory of God and the presence of God. But Jesus is gone. He's not with them anymore. They're alone. And they're scared. They are afraid. They don't know what to make of this. But they remember he told them, don't leave Jerusalem. You go back. And you wait. For what? The convicting power, the courage, and determination to break out at Pentecost. They were alone. You ever felt the absence of God? Where's God? I miss him. There's something or someone missing from my life. It's not here. I can't break through to him. I don't hear from him. He does nothing in my life. You ever felt that way? You may have felt that way for the past year. Where's God? Why doesn't he do something about all this? Absence is important. One day I was sitting in my office in the administration building at Martin College, and Tommy Yao, the president of the college, as he was accustomed to do regularly, came down to talk with me. And he talked about the ministry of absence and how important it is not to be always accessible or available, because you take on more significance and more importance if you're not available than when you are. It brings more power to the relationship. I'm going to start a statement, and you finish it. Absence makes what? Absence makes the heart grow fonder. Well, you can overdo it. But sometimes you might learn what I learned. I quit going to meetings, most of them at First Church Murfreesboro. I didn't like going to them anyway. And I had better things I wanted to do. You know, the places you have conflict and fights in the church is at Bible study and committee meetings. That's where it happens. It doesn't happen in here, in worship. It happens in those places. But I learned to send somebody to represent me. I'd send the secretary. Her workload increased greatly. I found out in being absent that she got done what I wanted done. That might not have happened if I'd have been there and had to fight with them about it. I had more authority, more power, more influence by not being there. Because I had to wonder what I thought. I reckon what he'd want to do. I don't know, but it worked. Until they ran me off. You know, I don't know if they had anything to do with it or not, but I sure did enjoy not going to those meetings. Well, the closest thing in life to an illustration of what I'm trying to say was my Uncle Gene Fuller. He was the sixth of seven children, and the last one to leave home, but not the youngest one. Everybody had begun to wonder if he's ever going to leave home. That was in a day when most folks got married when they were 18, 19, 20 years old. And he was approaching 28 and had no sign of marriage until she showed up. Not really kin to us, but not far from it. From Tacoma, Washington. First thing we knew, she went home and he went out there. And they got married. I remember the day he left. All of us gathered at the train station in Murfreesboro and watched him leave. We watched all the way down that track until the train disappeared. And we kept standing there, but we were crying. Gene was leaving. But you know, we thought more about him. We elevated his meaning in our hearts and souls because he was gone, absent from us. Remember the first time he came in, I think it was the first time he came home. We all the cousins and aunts and uncles and gathered at Ma and Pa Fuller's house. And we were waiting in Compton, Tennessee, out in the front yard and on the porch and all over the place, because he had told us he was coming. We kind of knew when that night, but not exactly. So we waited in the dark, and it got 2 o'clock in the morning, and then it happened. We heard the horn blowing on the other side of the hill. And then the lights topped the hill. It's Gene. He's coming. We all ran out to the front of the yard and were standing there when he got out of the car. And they had two little boys by then. Those were the wildest children we'd ever seen. If you rode all the way from Tacoma, Washington in a Ford car, when you got out, you broke loose. And they did. But then they went home, went away. And Gene took a bad sickness. And Mama and my Aunt Dot wanted to see him one more time before he died. They had never flown. I had. And they asked me if they paid my way, if I would fly with them to see Gene. And I did. We visited a while, and then as we were leaving, he was laying, whatever that word is, on his bed. And he could look out his window and see that beautiful snow-capped Mount Rainier. we gathered around his bed. I said a prayer. And as we were leaving his bedroom, he said the last words I ever heard him say. He said, "I'll see you in heaven." Those words still ring loud and clear in my mind. Well, Jesus left them alone, and they went back to the upper room in Jerusalem, and they had to think about what he meant and how important he was and what he'd taught them. And they spent 10 days doing that, and they prayed and they had fellowship together. And they wanted to be sure that what he started continued. He had chosen 12. There were just 11 left. They cast lots and chose Matthias. I don't know whether they made a good choice or not. You don't ever hear from him again. That's it. And I'm sure, I don't know. But they waited. But while they were waiting, they were getting ready. And then the time came. And they broke loose. They escaped their fears. They escaped the strangeness of their lives, and they went outside to live life again in his name and to do his work. Folks, time is going to come. I tell you, it's going to come when we're going to break free from this pandemic. We're going to rush out into life and live it again with him, serving him, doing his work. In the meantime, we pray, we plan, we get ready. We get ready. And I guess the question that is posed to me is, will I be ready when the time comes to break free? That's an important question for all of us. Right now, feels like he's not around. It's Ascension Sunday. And he ascended into heaven and sitteth at the right hand of God the Father Almighty. And from thence he shall come to judge the living and the dead. Well, I don't know. What do you think? In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit, amen.
Our closing hymn is "Thine Be the Glory." Let's stand and sing together.
Thine be the glory.
This morning that we need to plan to prepare and to get ready for the time when we will break forth into God's promises. Thank you for being here this morning, and for those of you who are listening online, we're glad that you tuned in, and as you leave this morning, will you receive the benediction, please? As you go this morning, may you go in the power and presence of the Holy Spirit, who continually reminds us that we need to plan and to prepare and to get ready for what God has in store for each and every one of us here in the body of Christ. Will you go in that assurance in the name of Jesus, our Lord and Savior? Amen. Thank you.
You can just leave your bells out because we'll be rehearsing again on Wednesday. So we can just leave them. We can maybe put them under our chairs. Put them under the chairs so they aren't real standing out for the next service.